This episode is sponsored by Frontend Masters. They have a terrific lineup of live courses you can attend either online or in person. They also have a terrific backlog of courses you can watch, including JavaScript Good Parts, Build Web Applications with Node.js, AngularJS in Depth, and Advanced JavaScript. You can go check them out at frontendmasters.com. This episode is sponsored by Hired.com. Every week on Hired, they run an auction where over 1,000 tech companies in San Francisco, New York, and LA bid on JavaScript developers, providing them with salary and equity up front. The average JavaScript developer gets an average of 5 to 15 introductory offers and an average salary offer of $130,000 a year. Users can either accept an offer and go right into interviewing with the company or deny them without any continuing obligations. It's totally free for users, and when you're hired, they also give you a $2,000 bonus as a thank you for using them. But if you use the Ruby Rogues link, you'll get a $4,000 bonus instead. Finally, if you're not looking for a job but know someone who is, you can refer them to Hired and get a $1,337 bonus if they accept a job. Go sign up at hired.com/JavaScriptJabber. This episode is sponsored by Rollbar. One of the frustrating things about being a developer is dealing with errors. Ugh! Relying on users to report errors, digging through log files to try debugging issues, or a million alerts flooding your inbox ruining your day. With Rollbar's full-stack error monitoring, you get the context, insights, and control you need to find and fix bugs faster. It's easy to install, and you can start tracking production errors and deployments in 8 minutes or less. We have a special offer for JavaScript Jabber listeners. Go to rollbar.com/JSJabber and sign up to get the Bootstrap plan free for 90 days. That's 300,000 errors tracked for free. Loved by developers at awesome companies like Heroku, Twilio, Kayak, Instacart, Zendesk, Twitch, and more, give Rollbar a try today. Go to rollbar.com/JSJabber.
My name is Nader Davit. I work at a company called School Status in Madison, Mississippi. We've been using React Native for about a year and a half, and we develop mobile apps and desktop apps and also web apps for K-12 schools. We do data visualization. We have schools in the Southeast United States for the most part. And
So I'm Mike, and I'm a React Native core contributor. I'm also the co-author of RNPM that has been recently merged to the React Native, and now it's known as a CLI. And I'm also a co-founder of CoolStack.io, which is a software house delivering React Native apps to our clients all over the globe. I think that's all.
All right. Well, let's go ahead and start at the beginning and give people a quick sketch of what React Native is. I know we've done other shows on it, but I like to just get the simple stuff out of the way so we can ask all the deep questions.
Yeah, so I guess I'll give you a quick overview from my point of view and why we like it and why I like it. So it's basically a way to build native performing mobile apps on Android, iOS, and also they're all already targeting Windows and desktop applications using mainly JavaScript. So basically the difference between React Native and something like a Hybrid or Cordova is instead of actually running a web view like Cordova or a Hybrid app would do, you're actually accessing native components. So the performance is really, really nice. And you're also able to access the native APIs directly just using JavaScript. So it's really great for web developers or JavaScript developers looking to get into mobile development, because you don't really have to learn a lot of other things. You kind of use your existing knowledge and you're able to build these really high quality mobile apps. And it's backed by Facebook. It's built using React. So if you already know React, it's easy to jump into because it's using very similar syntax, and you're also using the same state and props and things that you're used to when using React on the web, but you're able to target these other platforms.
Now, it works over JavaScript Core. I'll put a link to the in the show notes to the episode we did on the iFreak show for JavaScript Core. I also should point out that Nader and Mike and several other folks get together every week and do a show called React Native, which is part of devchat.tv. But I'm wondering, how is writing, because I know people are listening to this and they're going, well, you know, I keep hearing that I should write my applications with Swift or with Objective-C or with, you know, whatever other native technology. I guess it's a form of Java in Android. So, you know, are there things that you can't do with React Native that you can do with React Native?
Well, mostly no, I would say. Like you know, the power of React Native is that you can write native modules. So essentially, in case there is anything missing, if you are writing a mobile app, like if there is I don't know, lock screen controls missing or some Bluetooth interactions are missing, you can always write them. So, for example, we have been recently writing a media player in React Native, and there was no module like available to control the media player natively and control lock screen controls. So we just wrote the missing APIs and just ported them to JavaScript so that it was totally like doable from the JS without actually writing any native code by other developers. So that's a very, very important feature of React Native itself. Plus, like the native modules itself are a very, very nice abstraction because you can write them without actually being an expert in either Java or Objective-C. So for example, our developers that have little native knowledge can usually write some very, very simple native modules by just checking out the documentation and checking out the native APIs and just going through the documentation. So if you have some native knowledge or if you have a native developer inside your team, you can always ask them to port like a native component for you so that you can use them from the JavaScript. So you can always extend it. And I wouldn't say there are any limitations. There might be some limitations out of the box, but if you can write some things and if you know how to overcome them, you can do pretty much anything.
So I have a question about something that was kind of touched on when React Native first came out, which is this promise that you can share a lot of code between your native application and your web application, if you're building a web application in React. In practice, I mean, it's been out for a year and a half, a couple of years now. Do you feel like this is a thing that happens a lot in practice, or is it mostly just a tool you use to build cross-platform mobile applications, and it's a little more theoretical still, the idea of sharing components, for example, or flux architecture between your mobile and your web app?
So you're talking about maybe sharing the exact code between the web and the mobile app?
Yeah, I mean, obviously the way underlying, I mean, divs don't work on React Native, and the native wrappers or the components that are wrapped around native iOS things won't work on the web. But at some point, it's JavaScript, and you can share that stuff. Is that something people are doing a lot of?
Well, I can tell you for one thing, we're sharing a lot of our data architecture. So if you write like your data layer in Redux or in Flux or maybe even MobX, you can use that exact code in your web and your mobile app as long as you're kind of working with the same data structures. So that's been really nice. And there's actually a project out there called React Native Web, which actually compiles React Native code into web elements. So basically, what you're used to seeing...
The tables are turned.
Yeah, exactly. It's kind of crazy. So if you're used to using divs in web, then you would be using something called a view in React Native, which functions very similarly to a div. So basically what React Native Web would do, it would take the view and you would be able to compile your app down into a web app. So your views would be compiled down to divs, your styling would be compiled to CSS or to JavaScript styling, and your like text elements would be compiled to paragraph elements or spans. So that project is still in the works. So once that gets a little more robust and a little more stable, that idea of sharing web, mobile, desktop could be a viable option.
Yeah, like in the applications we are doing for our clients, we get a lot of requests about sharing like what they have already done in web with React Native. For example, like currently we are working on an application that already works with React.js on web. It's fully deployed and kind of has like 6 or a year of like commit history. And what we are essentially doing is we are just writing views because like the logic, as Nader said, like reducers, actions, they are already there. So we can just share them. We don't have to write any additional logic. Of course, sometimes there are places where you have to write something platform specific, but like speaking for JavaScript, like data layer can be fully reused if it's done properly. As far as native modules are considered, there is you have to think for yourself like where to draw the line between native code and the JS code. Like, for example, when we were doing some media player stuff that I've previously mentioned, we had to find a good balance between the JavaScript interface and the Objective-C and Java code so that we can not only write something that works like bugless on all platforms, but can be also reused like 100%. So we decided to go with as little native code as possible so that you can control the player, for example, from the JS. You can you can do all the shuffling, you know, play queue management from the JavaScript. And essentially, our native interface was just a set of four methods like play, stop, previews, and next. And that was all. And thanks to that, we could reuse like almost every like crucial piece of the logic, so that if there was a bug on iOS, for example, that music was stopping in the middle of a playback, we know that it's an issue in our JS code that is probably happening on Android as well. So thanks to that, when I fixed this on iOS, I was pretty sure the bug is going to be solved on Android as well. So it's always like a matter of finding a good balance, how much of native code there should be written and where and how much of JS there should be in the code. So I think it's totally possible. It's just you have to find that balance and just stick to it.
So related to Jameson's question, I'm wondering if I've done web development with React, how much of my skill is going to cross over into React Native versus, you know, how much, or I guess the other way of asking the question is, what else do I need to know besides what I would know if I'm familiar with React on the web?
Well, I can tell you in my experience, because I came from web development into React Native, but I've done a lot of hybrid mobile development before I got into React Native. One of the main things that coming into building native looking and native mobile apps versus hybrid or web apps, one thing that you have to kind of think about is certain UI elements that are platform specific. So like Android has a certain date picker that they use across most of their apps, and then they have toolbars and there's pickers and all these different native implementations. So thinking in that way is one thing that you have to kind of start doing when you move into this type of thing. But as far as just being able to grasp the language, if you're a React developer or you're a JavaScript developer, especially if you're a React developer, all of the actual syntax and the actual like language and building the actual components is very, very similar. There's a few things that are different. Things like thinking as far as your styling goes. You know, we don't have CSS, but we do have something that's very similar. They've actually ported over a Flexbox implementation, I should say, into React Native that allows you to do a lot of the similar styling that you're used to in CSS with slight differences. So, like, I would say you can take a lot of your knowledge and be able to get up and running with React Native fairly quickly. If you're using React, I would say very quickly. And if you're just coming from JavaScript, like if you're an Angular developer or just a Backbone or jQuery developer and you want to pick up mobile app development, I would probably say take a look at React and understand the React lifecycle and how props and state work, and then kind of jump into React Native after that.
You kind of brought up... go ahead.
Sorry. So I would also say that like tooling itself is important, because what I have seen like across JS developers, web developers coming to React Native, like the knowledge of Xcode, the knowledge of Android Studio, Gradle, and all this native tooling is super important if you want to ship your app, actually, because things are different on mobile side. Like there is no webpack, and you know, shipping your app is not just a matter of using Heroku or a similar service. But you also have to know how to kind of create an account on the iTunes, how to deploy your app, how to manage all the certificates and stuff. So that was also one of the reasons why we have built RMPM, just because like linking native libraries was super hard for users, because like essentially on web, you just NPM install something, require, and it's done. It kind of works. But on the native side, like on the React Native side, you have to like link your libraries, you have to add some native code, you have to bundle you know, other native dependencies. So the process itself is way more complicated, and you have to think of all these steps. So I would say tooling is important as well, because you just have to know that the process is different, and there are like a lot of things you have to consider when you are about to deploy your application and want to make it available for your users.
Can you actually go into a little bit more detail on that? Because so you guys first touched on about being able to use Flexbox, which is different from my understanding of what you would do if you were using like Swift or something like that. But then another cool thing is that if you're using React, you can do hot reloading. But then the other thing that I've read is that you don't have to go through the App Store to update your app. So I guess I'm bringing up all these things because I was just going to see if we could talk a little bit about, you know, everybody says like how great it is to share code. But it seems like there is actually also a lot more there other than just being able to use JavaScript and just being able to share code that's really valuable versus just using like Objective-C or Swift.
Yeah, I can go into a few of those things that were very beneficial for us. So we have a lot of native developers we have a few native developers in our company. So one of the main things that they said was a huge benefit and a draw for React Native versus native development was the fact that we do have the live reloading and the hot reloading. The hot reloading as far as being able to just save your app and being able to update the state of your app without having to compile it. So a lot of times if you're developing a native app, you have a compile step of anywhere between a few seconds to maybe a minute, depending on how large you are of an app you have. So like if you have just a small UI change, sometimes that would get really frustrating and developer time would be extremely long just to make a small change. So it's beneficial for companies because you're able to kind of develop apps a lot faster. And that's just one of the ways that it improves your speed of development. You mentioned the remote updating through the App Store. And yeah, there's a lot of services that are built now and a lot of different implementations of that as far as being able to update your app. So basically what you do is you build your initial version of your app, submit it to the App Store, and then as long as you're not updating any native code as far as any actual like Objective-C or anything like that, you're able to remotely update your app using one of many services. One of the best ones right now is actually Microsoft CodePush. So Microsoft has built a really, really nice way to do that. They have a nice API. It's free and it's really easy to use. And you can basically update things like you would on the web. So like if you're a native mobile app developer, you may be used to waiting a day up to a week to update your app in the App Store. Whereas if you're a web developer, you can update it on the fly. So with CodePush, you can update your native app on the fly. So that's a really beneficial thing as far as React Native goes.
That brought up an interesting thought in my mind, which is that as a web developer, you might not have an idea of what the constraints are of the native platform. So sometimes some of the pitches that I hear for React Native are like, if you're used to this crappy thing about mobile development, check out this awesome thing. And it's like, I didn't know that was a crappy thing. I just thought you could just deploy code easily or build fast or whatever. So it seems like part of the pitch for React Native is making web developers aware of here's what it's like without it. I have a question about kind of what... So Chuck already asked how much of the experience transfers over. And I have kind of a slightly different take on that question, which is, if I'm a web developer and I get into React Native, what's going to be hard for me besides the obvious things of like writing Objective-C or Android code or whatever? Like what will not be as seamless for me?
I think the tooling, as I like the tooling, I think is the hardest thing you have to kind of check out before you actually start writing anything. Like for example on iOS. Obviously, React Native ships with the command line tools. So, for example, you can run your app on the iOS on the simulator with just a command line, and you can run your app on Android with the command line as well. But you know, there are times where you have to open the Xcode, and you have to check out like, oh, you have to like bundle your app. You sometimes have to change the release scheme and you know, do a lot of configuration stuff. And this is not something web developers are used to. An Xcode interface is not like the best interface ever made. So sometimes people get confused how to change things and how, like even to understand why these things are like required, especially given that Apple is kind of super strict about like what can be inside the app, what cannot be inside the app. It has a lot of security concerns you have to consider, and you have to, for example, set up. Like sometimes with the iOS 9 release, you can't just access a random server because they are kind of whitelisted now. So if you are about to access like resources, you have to whitelist them in the configuration. And these are the things people are sometimes asking, like why this is required, or for example, why my like HTTP services are not working. So these are the things people are kind of trying to figure out. And these are the hardest things, I think, from my experience. There are like the biggest deal breakers for web developers when they are trying to actually write a React Native app.
Sure.
Okay, I have another question. Oh, sorry, was someone else going to go?
No, I was going to tell everyone that you had a question. But you did it yourself.
Yay me. So I feel like some podcasts I was listening to, they started going into details about this, but I was on a run and I was like half paying attention because I was running really hard. So I would like to actually go
like
into,
running away from something?
No. Like running on my run, like around the harbor. And I probably was like really hot, so half paying attention. Anyway, so I'm actually super interested if we could get into some, not just like talk about it at a surface level, but actually like get into some of the details about how it works. Bridging between the native APIs and React Native when React Native like doesn't support something.
Yeah, Mike, do you want to kind of pick this question up? Because I know you've done quite a bit of that.
Yeah, I know. I know that question was going to be asked. Well, after all, yeah. So speaking more in details, like there is a very very nice presentation given by Tadeusz Zagalo, which is the guy behind the iOS bit of the React Native. I'll share the link later after this talk, where like the bridge itself is explains very very much in details, but like speaking very briefly, what happens when you how like the bridging between native code and JS code works is that, for example, on iOS you create a class which is extending some React Native internal code, and then inside this class, you have to define the methods that your native code is going to expose to the JavaScript. So, for example, if on iOS you have a method that can be called, I don't know, call a number, you have to wrap it with a macro which is called RCT export method. And as soon as you wrap this method with this macro is going to be available on the JS side, and you can actually call it. So, so on a very very high level, When you wrap these methods with the macros that are available on iOS, then during the runtime of your app, all these informations are collected into a huge JSON, and that JSON is then transferred to the JavaScript. And based on the informations provided in that JSON, the React Native is able to actually kind of build the dynamic API based on that file. So if it receives, for example, an array, and inside this array, there is an information that your code is exposing, for example, 10 native modules, and all these 10 native modules have some certain methods. Based on that information, it will prepare an object for you where properties will be the names of your native modules, and each of these properties will have another object inside with properties that will be names of the methods you can actually call. So the API is built dynamically when your app starts based on the information provided by your native code. So the most important part when you are about to write a native module is to decorate the methods you want to expose. And after that, everything is done by React Native so that you can just keep calling them and providing the methods you want to call. Obviously, there are some constraints here because not everything can be passed or transferred through the bridge. For example, on iOS, you can pass some literals like strings, numbers, objects, And these are converted when, like during the call, these are converted. So for example, string becomes an NS string and object becomes an NS dictionary. And these are the objects from the core iOS library. But for example, you can't transfer NS date because this is a custom property that's not supported. So in order to pass a date object through the bridge to native code or from the native code to JS through the bridge, you have to convert it to string. So these are like the things you have to remember. But essentially what happens is there is like dynamic communication through the bridge and all these calls are queued up. So this native topic itself is kind of broad. So if you have more detailed questions, I'll be happy to answer. But as I said, like the API itself is built dynamically based on the information provided during the runtime, based on, you know, the native modules you have and the exported methods that you have decorated.
Yeah, we actually had a pretty good episode on React Native Radio about bridging native components with Tadu. So I think it's like episode 8. So if you're interested in that, or if anyone listening is interested in learning more about that, definitely check out that episode. And Google Tadu Zagala and look up his blog. He has some good stuff on there as well.
But first, you must spell his name.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
That's the biggest challenge.
We'll put this in the show notes.
Yeah, there you go.
He's a really smart guy. He knows lots of things.
Yeah, he also has a lot of cool stuff about the JS VM itself and how like the React code is executed on React Native. So if you are interested, for example, in learning more about how actually JavaScript code can be executed on iOS or on Android and how like the native views are transpiled and how that happens, that you can write a React component that then becomes a native component, you should definitely check out that talk, because like pretty much everything has been explained there in terms of the life cycle of what happens when you open up the app till you see the first view.
So one other question that I'm running across here is that, I just got back from Wood Badge, which is adult leader training for Boy Scouts. And one of my tickets or one of my goals is to write an iOS app that has cheers for Cub Scouts in it. And so I'm wondering, should I do this in Swift or should I do it in React Native, and why or why not? I stumped him.
Can you repeat the question? I was off on Google, like looking something up. So I apologize.
The question I have is, let's say that I'm going to build a new app, and it's a relatively simple app, right? It makes certain information easier to get, and you know there are like two or three types of data in it is all. Why should I use React Native, or why shouldn't I use React Native?
Well, if you're like a Swift developer or an Android developer and you're very comfortable building native mobile apps, then there's really no reason to use React Native if you're just targeting that single platform. But for most of us, we're not really versed in all these different platforms. So I guess the main argument for something like what you're talking about would be having the opportunity to build cross-platform using mainly the same code base. So pretty much all the apps that I've built with React Native so far, we kind of like to go through them and see what percentage of our code is being reused. And we're able to use anywhere between like 70 to 90% of our code cross-platform. So I guess the main thing would be, if you're not a very good Android and iOS developer, the main reason to go with something like React Native would be you'd be able to get the performance of a native mobile app, but only being able to understand a single platform. So like their original idea was learn once and write anywhere. And they've stuck to that, but they've also kind of moved also more towards the write once, run anywhere to an extent. So they're not saying you can pretty much just write the app a single time and have it run everywhere, even though that is theoretically possible if you stayed away from platform-specific APIs. But you would be able to reuse a lot of your code. So that would be, I guess, my argument for something like that.
And if it's not written in React, there's still just the idea that most of the code will cross over one way or the other.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
So the idea is you get the benefit if you've already written the app in React that you can share some of your code, but I haven't really done that. I haven't written it as a web app. So what you're telling me is the other advantage is that there are certain aspects of it that will cross over between both platforms, and I can effectively be on the two main smartphone platforms right out of the gate instead of having to learn Swift and then having to learn Java.
Exactly.
What were you going to say, Mike?
I was just going to say, like, from the developer perspective, what I have seen, like, when I was comparing my development of native applications with Objective-C to the development of even, like, iOS React Native apps, was that when I was dealing with complex JSON data structures, for example, when I was interacting with REST APIs, fetching some data, I have noticed that it's way easier for me to work with JS, for example, fetch APIs, and then transform this data with JS, then for example, writing some complex serializers and deserializers in Objective-C. So I would also say, if you are planning to do a lot of HTTP requests and operate on web data, and you want to write something super, super quickly, that's also like something to consider, to keep in mind, because it's going to turn out to be way more simple in terms of managing the data.
So I know the part. Whoa! I got some crazy echo going on. Does anybody else hear that?
I heard a little bit of it.
Okay. No. Well,
but I don't hear it anymore. So.
It's gone now. The mysteries of Skype. Who can fathom them? I know part of what we were going to talk about today, I thought, was the React Native in Action book, right?
Yeah. So I've been working with Manning for about 6 months now. We're putting together a book called React Native in Action. So it just went on sale yesterday, which was August 1st. We have three chapters so far. It's going to be a total of 12 to 14 chapters, and it's pretty much going to be a very comprehensive book. So if you're coming into React Native, or you're coming into mobile app development, and you kind of want to learn how to build mobile apps using JavaScript, React Native in Action would be a pretty good book for you to kind of check out. And you can read the first chapter online for free and kind of see if it's kind of what you're looking for. And if it is, it's available for purchase right now.
So how do you write a book about a technical topic like this that moves so fast? I mean, especially if you're going to talk about like the tooling or the modules or ecosystem or something like that? Or do you just not talk about that stuff and try and focus on the core that's not going to change?
Yeah, it's been pretty interesting. And, this is my first time actually putting together a full book. I've done quite a bit of blogging. I've done quite a bit of other forms of publishing as far as web stuff, but I've never actually put together a book. And working with them, they understand that this has been a very fast-moving technology. And already, just in the past few months, there's been a lot of API churn, and we've actually had to go and rewrite pretty much every chapter every month. When I say rewrite every chapter, we've pretty much had to go in and just pick out things that have changed and best practices that have changed, and things like the way that you import React and React Native from the platform changed. So pretty much everywhere, in there that we've referenced React Native, we've had to kind of go in and rewrite that. So I would say, one of the best things about dealing with, these e-publications like React, Manning and stuff like that is we are going to continue to keep the book up to date. So whenever something does change, we pretty much go in and update that. And something that's really interesting, actually, is the Navigator is very much in flux right now. So there is a few different ways to use navigation and routing in React Native, but they're actually deprecating the main way to do routing and navigation, and they're implementing a new experimental way to do navigation, but the API isn't stable yet. So we intended for that to be like around chapter 6 or 7, but for the sake of not having to rewrite the entire chapter, we're going to actually put that off towards kind of the end. We might write like a smaller chapter and kind of walk through all the different ways to do navigation, except for the experimental way. And then once that API becomes stable, we're going to go in and update that. But yeah, it's been very interesting. It's been a lot of work. It's been a lot of rewriting and testing and rewriting and testing. But overall, I think we're really happy with what we have so far. And if you are interested in learning about navigation and things like that without, you know, purchasing the book, I have quite a few blog posts on Medium. So I'm Dabbit3 on Medium, and I have quite a few different blog posts on the experimental navigator as well as some regular implementations of the navigator. And those are also being kept up to date with the API changes. Another book I would also recommend if you're into React Native is, so Arali put out a book called Learning React Native, and it's a little smaller or shorter of a book. It covers some of the same topics, but not so in depth, but it's an excellent book. In fact, I read it when it first came out. It's written by Bonnie Eisenman. So that's just another option too, if you're looking to learn React Native, I would check that book out as well.
That's cool. So you're not in competition with that book, trying to crush it.
No, definitely not. I love that book. So,
since things are so fast moving, do we know what's coming next?
So Mike is actually Mike actually handles the releases for React Native, and he's kind of closer to the metal there. So I kind of keep up with the updated versions that are coming on the React Native GitHub repo to kind of keep up with what's going to be coming and what to be working on in the book. But, you know, Mike can actually maybe speak a little more to that.
Yeah, so we don't have any upcoming roadmap, like what will happen in the next, like, few months. I guess that's something people at Facebook might know better. But speaking for the release process itself and what gets released every 2 weeks, because obviously React Native gets released every two weeks, we always release on top of the master. So if you want to check what's coming up next, you should just visit the React Native repo and see the latest commits that landed to master. From the biggest features that are going to land in like a few days, because there is going to be React 0.31, I guess, being released, is that we have fully reworked the command line interface to be more developer friendly, to have more examples and to have more features. And this is thanks to the RMPM that I've mentioned previously that we managed to merge. So these are like, this is the biggest like feature that's going to be added in the upcoming release. But as I said, if you are interested in like knowing more what's going to be released in next 2 weeks or in next month, you should definitely check the commits that have been merged to master, because essentially that's what we are that's how we are releasing the React Native versions. There is nothing like roadmap. There is obviously a product paints website where we are trying to list the most important for the community, the most important features for the community that are waiting for some contributions. So these are like the most likely to be implemented in the nearest future. So definitely you should check it out to see what's coming up next.
And I know you guys have done an episode or two on React Native, but you know, this is a fast moving framework like we talked about earlier, and there's constantly things being improved. So I was going to ask Mike to maybe speak about where React Native is today as opposed to where it was when it first came out, and why someone that may have had tried it in the past may want to come back and take another look at it if they weren't too happy with it or they weren't too interested in it when it first came out.
That's a fantastic question. Thanks for doing our job.
Yeah, actually, I've been wondering the same, like, earlier today, how React Native did change over, like, a year from, like, if we're trying to compare it with the old versions. I think like the biggest difference is the ecosystem itself. Like back in the day, a year ago, if you were about to write something, there was always like a module, a component that you were feeling like it's missing. If you wanted to make in-app purchases within your app, there was nothing to use. If you wanted to scan your credit card, there was nothing to use. Now all these modules are there, maintained by the community. So if you had a feeling that the ecosystem is not there yet, and if you had a feeling that something is missing and you didn't have native experience to write these missing things, now you can try to check it again, because it might turn out that all these things are already there. So this is one of the things that did change a lot. Also, like the API itself has became more stable. Like back in the day, React Native was shipping with React forks, so it was impossible. It was super hard to actually share components between platforms. For example, Redux used to have its own React Native entry point just because React Native was having a different React version. Now these things are no longer there because React Native is depending on normal React version. So this improved as well. And if you wanted to write a React Native app with reusing Redux in mind and with reusing some web logic in mind, now this is totally possible, and it did improve. So if you are about to do it again, or if you would like to check it out again, I think it's a good time, because, you know, like all these things improved and are improving. Documentation is improving. Like back in the day, there was a lot of missing places. The documentation was kind of confusing in a few places as well. Now we had revamped the documentation dramatically. It's now way better. It has more methods. It is more methods described. It is like it has more sections. So if you had problems with knowing some things, if you were unable to understand some certain things, if you found a lot of unanswered questions on Stack Overflow, now you can try to search for these questions again, because it's very likely that they are already answered, and you will probably find an answer in documentation for these particular things again.
If somebody is listening to the show and they're thinking, all right, well, my next app is going to be a native or is going to be a mobile app, and I think I want to try out React Native, how do they start a React Native project?
It's actually super simple, because all they have to do is they have to just open up the terminal and call React Native init and enter the app name. And that's done. I mean, after probably an hour after NPM install finishes, you can just run your app with a command line again. So all in all, it's just a set of two calls, React Native init app name, and then React Native run iOS, for example, and you are done. That's all you have to do in order to get a bare bones application that just says hello world. And you are ready to go, ready to explore the APIs and do whatever you want.
Do you need to use NPM to install a command line package or something?
Yes, you have to. First of all, you have to install the React Native CLI package, which is the global version of the package. Important thing about this is that it doesn't have anything hard-coded, so you don't have to update it. Like, you just have to install it like once in your life to have it on your machine, and it will automatically detect React Native from NPM, and then like the commands like run iOS, run Android, all these things are actually called from within your node modules. So if we announce something on Twitter, if we announce that, okay, CLI has a new command, you don't have to do anything because it will already be there for you. So just install it once and forget about it and just call init and you are set pretty much every time.
Yeah, and I also wanted to kind of speak about RNPM a little bit more, because I know when I first started with React Native and I wanted to implement some of these native modules or these native plugins for React Native, actually getting them to work and configuring them as a web developer took me a little time to understand, because when you, in the past at least, when you had to install a native module or a native package into your React Native project, you also had to do some configuration in Xcode, or you had to do some configuration in your Java file for Android. And if you're not a native developer, it was a little, a little hard, and it took some digging in and a little bit of work to do. But now RNPM is something that is built into React Native. So if you want to install one of these native modules, it's as simple as typing a single command. I think it's RNPM link. So you basically install the package of npm install, and then you run a command rnpm link, and then everything just works. And Mike can probably talk a little bit more about that because he is one of the people that kind of created rnpm.
So as you said, like the biggest problem we had back in the day was that when we wanted to actually use a third party module that had some native code inside, not only we had to run npm install, but we also had to perform some certain actions that were different for every single module based on the native code or native components these modules were having. So this is kind of complicated for web developers because on native side, you not only have native code like Objective-C or Java code, but you also have some libraries and some native libraries that you have to link to your project. And these steps are not done automatically. You can't just have them added to your project for you automatically. So after installing a module, you have to open your Xcode. You have to locate some build settings, which is a tab in Xcode. And then you have to add some header search paths. You have to perform some other certain things like include a static library into your project. And, you know, people are not only trying to find these places, but they are also wondering what a static library is. So what we wanted to do is to make a tool that will abstract away all these things and will make installing a native library for React Native as simple as npm installing anything else. So now that rnpm is merged into React Native, there is nothing actually you have to perform. Like, all you have to do is you have to just call React Native install instead of npm install and provide a name of the module you want to add. And yeah, as I said, like, everything else will be done automatically for you. And I think this is a pretty cool feature because, like, in most cases, the linking steps, the manual linking steps, were simple because you just had to do three things. And after doing this for like a month or two, you already learned them, so you were doing this automatically. But then let's say you wanted to integrate CodePush. And if you go to the CodePush GitHub repo and you check out the README installation steps, you will see that there is like way more things to do. You have to provide some configuration. You have to set up keys, tokens. You have to attach some native libraries, SQL libraries, or something else. And this is getting super tricky, not only to add to your project, but then think about uninstalling a native dependency. It's very, very likely that you may break something because these third-party native dependencies may overlap across all your or your React Native dependencies. So as I said, like rnpm is the tool that makes this super easy for you because you don't have to think about it. Like, if you are a web developer, you don't have to learn what a static library is or what a native library is or how's React Native dependency different from regular JS dependency. If they are all in npm, they should be the same. So as I said, like, this tool is there to make it easy for you, to make this initial steps easier for you to start with React Native.
All right. Well, everyone got real quiet. So let's go ahead and get into our picks. Amy, do you want to start us off with picks?
Sure. I have one, and I'm not going to say the full title because I don't like to cuss. But anyways, it is a talk by Kathy Sierra, who I actually was not really terribly familiar with, but apparently she is amazing from everyone who responded as I posted this on Twitter. But it's a talk called Making Bad A Developers. And it just kind of talks about, I think, like, using your mental energy wisely when you're developing something. So I got a lot out of the talk. And she's just, like, a phenomenal speaker as well. So that probably makes the talk, too. And I'll put a link in the show notes. That's it for me.
All right, Jameson, what are your picks?
I have four picks, and two of them are self-serving. I'll do those first. My first pick is... surprise, surprise. It's React Rally. It is a community React conference in Salt Lake City, August 25th and 26th. This might possibly go out before the conference starts. We're working on a live stream. That depends on a couple things, but for sure we will record the talks and have them up on YouTube soon after the conference. Tickets at this point are almost sold out, so they might be sold out by the time this airs, but we'll see. We might have some more. But I would love to see you there. My next pick is another podcast that I'm on called Soft Skills Engineering, where we talk about the kind of non-technical side of software development. It's Dave and I, so two JavaScript Jabber people. We got a website this week, and we're just so proud of being all grown up and having a website. So you can see all our episodes at softskills.audio as a way to subscribe to. And then my next two picks are just two books that I've been reading lately that I've really enjoyed. One is Practical Object-Oriented Design in Ruby. It's a Ruby book, but guess what? It's good no matter what language you program in. It's been really interesting to read it and think, how would I solve this from a more functional programming aspect too? Just really good information on how to design code that's easy to maintain. And then the second book is The Algorithm Design Manual. I did a CS program in college, and I took a course on algorithms and another one on data structures, but it's been a long time since I've really looked into that stuff. And this is a pretty, I'd say it's a pretty approachable book. Some of these are very like mathematical and formal and kind of difficult to read as just a working programmer, but this one is really well written and also really interesting too. So those are my picks.
All right, I'm going to jump in with a few picks. Generally, we talk about picks as something that made your life better or something that you're working on or enjoy. And I really had a pretty impactful experience last week. As I mentioned before, I was at WoodBadge. If you're not familiar with what WoodBadge is, it's training for adult leaders in the Boy Scouts of America. I think they also have it in England and, you know, other countries as well. But anyway, it was just, I don't know how to describe it, but I feel like more than just being a more capable Boy Scout leader, I feel like I'm a more capable leader in general and a better person for having gone. So I really, if you're involved in Boy Scouts at all and you're considering going, just go. The other thing I'll say about it is that I have attended leadership training in the past, and I've seen leadership training programs on par with WoodBadge, and they usually cost thousands of dollars, $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 I've seen them cost. WoodBadge, if you're a Boy Scout leader, or even if you're not, it's open to anybody, but it is $130, I think, for adults in the U.S. So you have to camp out. That's part of the deal, but it is definitely worth it. So anyway, so I'm going to pick WoodBadge. I'm also going to really quickly pick the Boy Scouts of America, just because I think it's a terrific organization that teaches young men and young women, if they want to join an explorer crew, or a venturing crew, sorry. If they want to join a venturing crew, they can do that. And it teaches them strong values and really gets them involved in a terrific organization. The mission of the Boy Scouts is actually to teach young people to make good life choices based on the values in the Boy Scout oath and law. So I think people are on board with most of the principles there, and I think it's a terrific organization that does a lot of good in the world. Lastly, I'm going to pick the scout camp that we were up at. Beautiful area. It's called Camp Typhi Scout Camp. It's part of the Mountain Dell Scout Ranch. It's right above Mount Pleasant, Utah, if you know where that is. But anyway, if you don't know where that is, don't worry, because Mount Pleasant's a really small town. We were up on kind of a bench above the valley, so you could look out over the valley. Beautiful scenery. They had, I think we saw four or five point bucks just walking across the open area in the camp. And it was just wonderful. So great place to go. And I know that they have activities that you can go up and do without actually attending the scout camp. But if you're looking for a place to go and, you know, a nice place to visit, then that's definitely a place that I would recommend. So yeah, those are my picks. Natter, what are your picks?
Yeah, so I have three picks. My first pick is going to be the Angry Birds movie. I wasn't really too hyped up to see that movie for some reason, because I'm not a big fan of the game. But if you have kids or if you just like animated movies like me, then I highly recommend watching it. It was like extremely entertaining, great animation. It was just a really fun movie. My second pick is an app called Enki. It's spelled E-N-K-I. And you can sign up for the wait list. I signed up for the wait list, and it took about a week, and I got an email and was able to download the app. It pretty much gives you five-minute daily workouts for dev skills, and you can pick whatever programming language you're looking to learn. I'm on Python, JavaScript, and Ruby. And right now, they only have JavaScript actual exercises, but Ruby and Python are coming up. And what it does is basically sends you a push notification every day, and it gives you like five different new things about a language, and you can kind of pick what skill level you are. So either beginner, intermediate, or advanced. And I've learned a lot, and I really enjoy it, and it lets me fit in a little bit of extra learning every day. And my last pick is something we already talked about. It's my book. It's called React Native in Action for Manning Publications. So if you're listening to this podcast and you're looking to learn more about React Native, go download the first chapter. It's free. And check out the book if you're interested in the rest of it.
Awesome. Mike, what are your picks?
I have three picks as well. So the first pick is the React Native Europe conference that will happen next year, probably in quarter three in Poland. And it's going to be the first React Native conference to happen in the world. So if you are like looking for learning more about React Native and kind of hearing more about native modules and how React Native can help your dev team and help your apps to go on both platforms and on all platforms, you should definitely sign up to our newsletter on our website and wait for the tickets. It will be happening next year, and Poland is a really great country to visit, so definitely don't forget about it on your list. The second pick is the React Native Apple TV. Apple TV is obviously the digital media player by Apple, and I'm pretty sure like you guys all have heard of it before. So there is that guy called Doug Lauder that had made a fork of React Native where he added a support for Apple TV. And it's supposed to be working pretty well because, you know, the APIs between iOS and Apple TV are pretty similar. So if you are having an Apple TV at your home and mobile development is not your toy, you can kind of try to get this up and running and probably build an app on your TV. I don't know, a game or kind of a streaming platform, whatever you want. It should be fun. And my last pick is going to be a little bit of self-promotion. If you are in San Francisco or living nearby, there is a React Native meetup happening on November 16th. I'll be there speaking about native modules. So if you'd like to have a chat, have a coffee, or to learn more about kind of adding native code to your JS apps and making it cross-platform, just be there and, you know, we'll see there now. I'll probably start once again with this one. So my last pick is going to be a React Native meetup that's happening in San Francisco on November 16th. I'll be there speaking about native modules. So if you'd like to hear more about how we have built that media player I've been talking about previously, how to add in native code to your app and make it cross-platform, just be there. We'll have a coffee and share our experience.
Sounds good. You should stop off in Utah on your way back.
I'll do. Actually, I have a list of places to visit, so I'll be having a car. Yeah, definitely.
Is Mississippi on that list?
I have like half of US on my list already, so I'm not really sure how this all will fit in my visa allowance of 3 months, but I'll try to make it.
I'll let you sleep on Jameson's couch.
You're welcome. Sounds like too. There's a 9-month-old baby, so there may or may not be a lot of screaming at night from human or from adults and babies together.
All right. Well, we'll go ahead and wrap this up. I just want to put in another plug real quick, though. If you're a React Native developer or you're interested in React Native, go check out React Native Radio. That's at reactnativeradio.com. And see what they've been up to. How many episodes do you guys have now? 33, 34?
We're on number, we just recorded number 36.
Okay. So yeah, definitely check that out. You can also, if you go to the JavaScript Jabber page on the top, there's a drop down for shows and it's listed there in the shows. So
Kevin Old is also awesome on there.
Yeah, absolutely. We have, so Kevin Old, Jed Watson, and Ali Najafizadeh, me and Mike are kind of the regular panelists. So we come and go.
All right. Well, we'll go ahead and wrap up the show. Thank you both for coming, and we'll catch you all next week.
See ya.
Bye. Getting back to work.
Bye, y'all.
See ya.
Bye.
Getting back to work. Why do you have to end on a downer?
Maybe. It depends if I fix this bug or not.
I have confidence that you will fix it, Amy.
I am so close. Oh, Jameson. Oh. You know what?
Yeah, I was going to mention, since you're moving to Nashville, about Kevin Ull, but I guess you already know him.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, because that's where I went to my boot camp. I feel like I know a bunch of the people there, and I'm just kind of moving back home close to friends and family and stuff. So, yeah, I'm really excited to go back there. But anyways, okay, getting back to work.
All right, we'll catch y'all later.
See ya.
Bye, you guys. Thanks for having us on.
Yeah. Thanks for coming on short notice.
Yeah, thank you.
Bandwidth for this segment is provided by CacheFly, the world's fastest CDN. Deliver your content fast with CacheFly. Visit CacheFly.com to learn more.